Dr. Rakeet, that was great. Okay. I just don't want to hold you back from lunch, because then you'll get hangry. That's not fair to anybody. Okay, well, it's a great pleasure. Now for us to introduce PTC Therapeutics. I don't know, is this the first time that we'll be introducing Dr. Ed Weeber as no longer our Dr. Ed Weeber of the University of South Florida, but he is our Dr. Ed Weeber, part of PTC Therapeutics. So Dr. Weeber has taken a new position outside of the University of South Florida as the Vice President of Neuroscience at PTC Therapeutics. So we're so proud of him because that's an amazing opportunity. And he doesn't need much of an introduction, nor does Stephanie. Dr. Ciarlone was a postdoc in Dr. Weeber's lab, and now she's a PhD. She's working in the drug development division at PTC Therapeutics, and she's focused on the outcome measures and some of the assessments that they're utilizing potentially for a future clinical trial in gene therapy and Angelman syndrome. So welcome to both of you.
Thank you so much, Allison, for the introduction, and thank you so much for having us. As she mentioned, my name is Stephanie Ciarlone. I'm with PTC Therapeutics, and it's really a pleasure to see all of you and a lot of familiar faces here and be here today to discuss with you our program alongside Dr. Weeber. Let's see if we can get this to change. Got pointed somewhere specific. Can I do it from here? Okay. So just a little bit of an introduction to PTC. PTC is a 20-year-old science-led rare disorder company with a heavy R&D focus in RNA-based therapies as well as small molecules. Our first approved therapy was in Translarna in Duchenne muscular dystrophy. And since then, we've expanded into multiple indications, and over the past few years have done this through additional products as well as through the acquisition of Agilis, a gene therapy company of which many of you are well aware. And all of this fits within PTC's vision of being a fully integrated, innovative rare disorder company with multiple platforms, multiple indications, as well as a global footprint. We're committed to a gene therapy platform that is both differentiated and scalable. So overall, initially, we have focused on monogenic disorders that can be treated throughout the lifetime, leading potentially to a larger treatment window. Moreover, we're focused on targeted dosing, meaning that we're focused on delivering the vector to specific targeted cells of interest in the CNS, which could potentially lead to lower dosing. And finally, our commercial model in PTC is to cultivate centers of excellence to overall have multidisciplinary care for each and every patient. We have a relatively broad gene therapy pipeline that does have a focus on rare CNS diseases. So our AADC deficiency program is actually on track to have a BLA filed by the end of this year. Our Friedreich's ataxia program, we plan to be in the clinic mid-2020. And we did want to say that Angelman syndrome is our third publicly announced indication, and we just wanted to stress that we've prioritized Angelman syndrome, and we are fully committed and dedicated to this program. Other than that, we do have cognitive disorders in the pipeline that have not yet been publicly announced. However, it's a really exciting time, so we continue to grow and expand with PTC. And with that, I'll pass it off to Dr. Weeber to talk with you a little bit more about the history of the Angelman syndrome program.
This is amazing, yeah. They were talking about the expansion of the amount of people that come to these things. I remember having a mini scientific symposium in the restaurant, Houlihan's. Who was at that one? There, see some hands, yeah. I remember the one where Scott Dindo almost passed out because his tie was too tight. Does anybody remember that one? Yeah, I noticed he's not wearing a tie today. So during my time at USF and over the years that I've done AS research, we planted a lot of seeds, and this really was one of the seeds that we planted that has really moved forward and started to approach clinical trial. And this was the AAV that we injected into the hippocampus of the AS mouse. Allison showed this picture before, but it's actually pretty important. We targeted the hippocampus, and we used AAV to deliver this gene. And you can see that that if you cut the hippocampus in a certain way, all the cell bodies line up, and that's what you see in that architecture there. And you can see in the non-genetically altered mouses up in the left-hand corner, like I said, be the right-hand corner. And then below is our AS mouse model with no protein. So we can stain for the UBE3 protein. We injected in the hippocampus. We waited 5 weeks. And then when we looked at the brain and did that staining, you could see the UBE3A being expressed in all those neurons. And we actually got it up to a fairly high level in the hippocampus of those animals. And it was sufficient enough to recover a lot of the symptoms that we see in the mouse. So the synaptic plasticity, learning and memory, a lot of those defects completely went away with that single injection of AAV. So that was an important scientific discovery. And as I'm learning now that I'm in a different position, that transitioning from scientific discovery to things that are more clinically relevant is difficult but important. And so we started doing more and more work concerning the AAV that was associated with how we would go about looking at this in a more clinically relevant way. And so one of the things that we did was we changed the mouse gene into a human UBE3A gene. We wanted to see if that UBE3A gene was actually functionally working. You know, it's an enzyme. Is it actually working if you express it with an AAV? We looked at several different AAV serotypes and different ways that we can get it into the brain. And then we started doing some work in a rat model that was produced by the FIRE team to look at efficacy and distribution. So I think Dr. Wilson really kind of hit this on the head, as he usually does. And I follow him on these, and he has a very good way of talking about this. But safety, getting the AAV past those barriers, these are all very important things that have to be determined and really put through the paces before we can go into clinical trial. So safety is first, and then efficacy after that. We're worried also, or at least it's a challenge and a consideration, about what kind of percentage of UBE3A do we need to have expressed. But I know it's been brought up before, and it's been a question that's been given to me about overexpression of UBE3A. You know, what may happen if you have too much UBE3A in those neurons? And we've tried to address that as well. We've put AAV into a non-genetically altered, so a neurotypic rat, and then said, if we produce over 100%, what do we see? And we don't see much. We don't see any change in the behavior, in the biochemistry, morphology of the neurons, or in the learning and memory, or synaptic function in the brain of those mice and rats. So as we're moving forward with this, we're always have an eye on what needs to be done to get into clinical trial. What are the relevant experiments that have to be done? I've stood up here in front of many of you, and it's increasing yearly, as somebody who is dedicated and very committed to seeing something happen with Angelman syndrome and to see a cure happen. And we've used that word for a long time, and I think we can still use that word. It's also, I'm very proud and happy to be part of a company who's also fiercely committed to Angelman syndrome. And so it's great to be back here again. And I'm sure I'll be back here next year as well to talk more about our therapeutics. And with that, I'll send it back to Stephanie.
Just to wrap it up with a status update for PTC. So what have we been up to and where are we today? So other than taking part in the A-bomb that Allison mentioned earlier to really stay up to date with the latest thinking for the best biomarkers and outcome measures to use in clinical trials for Angelman syndrome, we just want to stress that, as Ed mentioned too, we're moving as quickly but also as safely as possible to conduct the necessary animal studies that we would need to support a first-in-human clinical trial. So currently we're contracting out manufacturing, and we have publicly announced a collaboration with Aldevron to support this manufacturing. However, that being said, we have also acquired a state-of-the-art biologics facility in New Jersey, which we plan to transition to an in-house facility. So PTC will be going end-to-end. We're currently establishing internal manufacturing processes so that PTC can provide the best products for both clinical trials and human use. So what can you do to help? Other than just general record keeping from your child's physician visits, as well as the tests that are being done and when, also, as Allison mentioned, taking part in the Global Angelman Registry would be very helpful. Not only signing up, but really filling out as much information as possible and keeping that as up-to-date as possible would really give us and others a robust data set to be able to openly access to learn so much more about Angelman syndrome and also hopefully help inform successful clinical trials. And with that, that's the end of our talk. I just want to say thank you so much again for having us. And other than myself and Dr. Weeber, we have a few others from PTC here in the crowd. Please feel free to come up and introduce yourselves. We love meeting with the families, and we look forward to chatting with you. Thank you.
So we're going to break for lunch, right? It's lunchtime. Yeah. You have something you want to say?
No, just let them know that they could have somebody's tables.
Excellent. So we're going to, lunch is being served right outside. If I can ask you kindly to go outside and pick up your lunch, there likely will be a long line. We're going to be starting back up at 1:15, but exactly 1:15. So if you can bring your lunch back in here, you can come and sit at these open tables up front, just so you have a little more space. And I encourage you to please stay back in here. We're going to start exactly back up at 1:15. Thank you very much.